but it's the one and only Morgan McDonald. Morgan, thanks for joining us. The camera's right over there.
You can look anywhere you want.
Yeah, thanks for having me. This is awesome.
How are you feeling? How's that ankle doing?
Well, I don't know. It's not great, but who cares? Tonight is not about me. It's about these guys racing.
Amen.
All right, so we've got some 5Ks coming up. In this one, we've got – well, I guess who are you most excited about? When these fields were first assembled, you know, we had a couple changes later on, but, like, who did you have your eyes on initially as, like, someone I have to watch out for?
Well, obviously, the big guys for me initially were probably the on guys, like Joe Klecker and Ollie, especially Ollie because – I mean, that guy just ran 3:32, and who knows what he's capable of right now. He's very strong, so he can run a fast 5K for sure. But obviously, there are a lot of other people. I think Willie Fink. I think he's really good.
He's been the most underrated.
We're big on buying stock on Willie Fink.
I think he's one of those guys who, you know, his breakout happened at the start of 2020, so it coincided with the COVID stuff.
Exactly.
And so you didn't get to see the full potential of it, but I think he's very good.
And he did win the mile last weekend at the JDL Fast Track down in North Carolina. And so, you know, a nice little tune-up leading into a 5K. For you, Morgan, what do you find is the best way to prepare for a 5K? Is there anything that you do in training maybe a little bit differently or the races leading in versus when you're preparing for a 1500?
Yeah, for me, I feel like I can run a 1500 off just whatever, essentially. Not to discredit the event or anything, but I really like a 1500 or a 3K going into a 5K. I think getting a race in at that faster pace is really good because the thing with the 5K is I think it's the most painful event, honestly.
Have you done a 10K?
I've done one at conference. I don't know if that counts.
Okay.
We jogged around a bit. But the 5K is there's so much discomfort whether you're running, you know, 63, 64, 65. Like that pace is never comfortable. So getting in some form of an effort, which is a bit faster than that in a race form, I think sets you up really good to race a 5K.
So these conditions here in Austin right now tonight, I know personally my hands are a little sweaty.
It's a little humid.
Yeah. Does that affect the athletes' minds going into a 5K, or is it maybe just short enough that it doesn't matter?
Yeah, I would say the athletes are going to be very hot and sweaty. They're definitely going to be very hot and sweaty, and I think inevitably that might have a bit of an impact, but I think 5K is still short enough that it's not going to do anything too crazy to you as long as you know, don't like freak out about it or anything. I think these are still great conditions for 5K racing.
Now, I'm a diehard fan of your YouTube channel. You
Thank
know
you.
That.
Thank you.
Is there anyone who's a bigger fan? Maybe not.
Not that I've met.
Yeah.
Well, so actually, I want to get the YouTube chat going. Let's get some Morgan McDonald chants going in the YouTube chat.
Yeah, this is on YouTube. Yeah. Yo, guys, check out my account.
So, Morgan, I know that your girlfriend is from Austin, Texas, and one of my favorite YouTube videos of yours is that long run in which you didn't drink enough water and slowly came to a halt over the course of, I believe, 18 miles.
Yeah.
So what is the preparation like in these slightly warmer conditions?
Definitely you need a lot of water, more than I had on that particular long run. That was me just falling apart for 18 miles, essentially. But then that was also the food a lot. You got to make sure you eat a lot. I'm sure everyone that's racing tonight has done, I hope at least, they've done better preparation for their race tonight than I did for that long run, because that was not pretty. That was very painful. But, yeah, you're definitely going to drink a lot. But, you know, I don't think it's honestly that different to any other race, because you don't want to drink too much water on race day. You don't want to feel like you got too much water in your belly or anything. So I think it's pretty normal, actually. You're just going to be extremely dehydrated at the end.
Is there a certain race day meal that you always take to? Maybe a little bit different for that 1500 versus the 5K?
No, I'm really not that type of person. I like to kind of consciously have no race day superstitions or like things that I need to do, just because if you can't do that, then that might mess with you mentally. So I'm pretty relaxed. I'm lucky, like my stomach can handle a lot of stuff, so it's not really a big issue for me. But I'm a normal, just like every single other runner, you know. I eat oatmeal, I eat sandwiches, nothing too crazy.
Can you update, I guess, like the people watching, just like what is your, I know we've talked enough about just like the process on getting to the Olympics for the United States, but what does your process look like?
Yeah, it's a little more confusing. It's a little more complicated. Australia has a policy where they have one automatic spot from the trials if you have the standard, and then the rest of the spots are up to more selectors' discretion. So, you know, I have an exemption to not race the nationals this year. I think they're in March. And with COVID and everything, it just doesn't really make sense. You know, you have a 2-week hotel quarantine and that. So luckily, I don't need to do that, which is nice. And so for me at this point, still McSwain has a spot if he wants it. Obviously, he won the Nationals, which is actually last year, and he has the time. But apart from that, it really comes down to just running quick enough or, you know, doing well enough in races where you get your ranking high enough is pretty much it.
Was it a difficult decision for you upon graduation to decide to stay in the States, or were you considering moving back home?
No, it was pretty easy for me. I mean, I knew that with the depth of the pro running here in America, it's just another level to Australia. Australia is so much smaller. There's not too many options. So the U.S. was always where it was going to be for me.
What's been your favorite part about training with Joe and Team Boss?
Man, it's been such a good transition. It's honestly so fun. Joe and I work really well together. You know, I'm someone who likes to get after, likes to try and do a lot of stuff, and he feeds into that a lot. And you know, we get to go train in these beautiful locations, Crest Butte, Boulder. So I love that as well. But there's a lot of great stuff, you know. Coming out of college, I stayed with Mick for a bit, but I felt like I kind of needed that switch a bit to get to a more like kind of pro environment, and that's what it's been. It's been perfect.
So you are sponsored by Under Armour. Is there,
correct.
You know, we talk a lot about the shoes and whatnot right now and the different gear. I always think that you guys have one of the coolest uniforms out there. But
thank you.
Any takes? How are things going over there? I saw that you weren't willing to share some of the stuff on a YouTube channel on some things dropping. But where's your head at? And is there anything you can preview or give away right now?
Well, they do have some new flats coming out next week, which I'm pretty excited about. The Flow Wind, I believe they're called. Those are the shoes that I couldn't show on video. But yeah, apart from that, they're just doing what they can. You know, they've got a lot of stuff in development, and I think it's gonna be pretty good, but it's not quite ready yet.
So you ran a great 2 mile at the New Balance Indoor Grand Prix last weekend. Is that last week already?
Yeah, we've lost track of time.
That was 2 weeks ago. We don't know time.
Me neither.
Tell me about that race. How did it feel? Was that about what you were expecting?
We've got the 5K right. Coming up.
Let's run through these real quick, and then we'll hear more from Morgan. But in hip 1, Kirabella Rasa, 2, Bia Simbasa, 3, Joseph Tessema, 4, Erica Vila, 5, Hillary Bohr, 6, Ryan Hill, 7, Willie Fink, 8, Kieran Lum, 9, Mason Furlick, 10, Maximilian Thorwith, and in hip number 11 is Ben Flanagan. A reminder, the Olympic trials qualifying time is 13:25, and the Olympic standard is 13:13. Also, in the descending order list of the rankings, it's the 42nd. You have to be in the top 42. I can explain more of that maybe in a little bit. And the lights are set to be at 13:20 pace. They're looking about 63s tonight.
This men's 5K is presented by Nate Greik. Nate is currently training for the 2021 Paralympic Games, where he'll be representing Canada. He's got deep roots in the sport of track and field, so he stepped up, messaged us, and said, hey, you know what? I want to support this race. He actually sent us something to say here. He said, it's so great to have an opportunity to be the sponsor for the men's Olympic 5K. I only feel it's fitting with two fellow Canadians in the field and my college teammate Trip Hurt pacing. He's like, I want to support this race for a few reasons. First is the sport of track and field was a saving grace for me after my traumatic brain injury in 2005. Additionally, many of us fans and runners have conversations about what we'd like to see in our beautiful sport of track and field. Instead, we've been complaining about it, but now I've decided to do my part in supporting such a great meet. So thanks to Nate for sponsoring this race.
And so behind the two rabbits, we have Willie Fink, Morgan's pick for tonight. Then we have Mason Furlick, and then we have Maximilian Thorwith, the German athlete, who actually came up to me yesterday.
This is a great story.
He came up to me yesterday when we were hanging out at the track, and he said he just wanted to introduce himself because apparently 5 years ago...
Sent you a DM.
He slid into my DMs asking some questions, some advice, and thankfully I responded, and he said it was really good advice and helpful, and so for that reason alone, I'll be rooting for Maximilian.
So in that 2 mile, Morgan, that you did at Ocean Breeze, I believe like Maximilian was in that race as well. So, I mean, like, what can you take from a 2 mile like that and apply it to a 5K like this?
Yeah, like I said before, that's kind of your perfect preparation where you're just racing it slightly quicker for a little bit shorter, and it just gets you ready to go. I think after an effort like that, Max is gonna be feeling pretty good. But yeah, for me, the 5K is all about staying relaxed for as long as possible. So, you know, if you've done a 2 mile a little bit quicker, you feel confident that you're able to do that. And these guys, you know, they're running pretty quick. They're running 64s right now. That's definitely not easy, but I'm sure after racing at, you know, 62, 63s for 2 miles, it feels a little better.
Yeah, so they were 2:39 at the K.
They're a little bit ahead of the lights right now.
Yeah, no, they're very perfect. And I believe, as we said, those lights were set for 13:20, and that is 240 per K, 64s. You know, I've decided that, you know, where others will say go out to your local high school track, and that's kind of their trademark. For me, I'm just talking about negative splitting. That's going to be my trademark, I've decided. And for the 5K tonight, going out, running 13:20 pace, being comfortable. And Morgan, I would love for you to kind of speak on that, the importance of feeling really good in the beginning of the race. Because I know in the 2 mile, you guys didn't necessarily go out at a blistering pace, but still were able to close very hard.
Yeah, I think it's very surprising how much you can make up in the last mile of one of these races, you know, as opposed to going out too hard and kind of dying a little bit. It's such a long way. It's both from a physical and a mental standpoint. You want to be able to relax. So, you know, if you can run, I think something like, if you can run 2:4:16 and then your third mile is a low 4, you know, that's close to a 13 flat, a 5K right there. So if you can really close hard, it makes such a big difference. And I mean, these guys, I'm sure they're going to be able to do it tonight. It's going to be good.
So I actually just got a text from Coach James McCurdy, and he was saying, just given the conditions tonight and the heat and the humidity that they are running in, a 4:14 mile will probably feel a little bit more like a 4:21 mile. Morgan, any validity there?
Yeah, I've had a very hot and humid race at the 2018 Com Games Trials, the Australian Nationals, and it was one of the toughest races of my life. I will say, these 5Ks, you know, that pace never feels easy, so that humidity just makes it even tougher.
So they came through the mile in 4:16, just clicking off those 64s, feeling really good. Willie Fink is up front behind Trip Hurt, our rabbit, who's doing a great job. Everyone is just lined up, hugging the rail, hugging the brickyard, and feeling hopefully good still, Morgan? Is that fair to say?
Yeah, this is exactly what you want as a 5K runner. You want to switch off and not think. You want a pacer that can hit his splits and then a nice line behind him. So everyone behind him is so happy right now. This really can't go any better. Willie Fink, he's right behind the pacer. That's a bit of a tough spot to be, you know, because at some point, not that far away, that pacer is going to step off, and then you have some decisions to make whether you want to keep pushing it or whether you want to sit and let someone else take it. But they're all looking pretty good at the front there, I think.
So out there in the back, you can see a little bit of Ryan Hill peeking out to try and make a little bit of a move in his position.
In December, we saw a big breakthrough from Eric Avila, I believe, at the Sound Running. And he ran a 5K in 13:18.
His previous PR before that had been 13:43.
So what is that like, Morgan, when you have now successfully run a 5K? He's made a big jump before. Does he now maybe approach this, and is he willing to take a different risk that maybe last time it may have been a little bit too scary of a jump?
Yeah, speaking from personal experience, that confidence that you've done it before helps a ton. However, I can say that you also are still afraid, because when I ran my big 5K PB, I remember it being the most painful thing I'd ever done. So, you know, I remember on the second lap just being in so much pain. So I knew it was going to be crazy. I knew to run faster was just going to hurt more. So I think it helps to be prepared for that. But, you know, you still always, you know, it's never, nothing's going to be given to you. You know, you got to take it. And it's never easy.
Is it fair to say that's a little bit different than a 1500? Because oftentimes your best 1500s almost feel easy.
I agree. It's crazy how that works. But 5Ks, sometimes they feel easy, I will say. But most of the time, it's such a grind out there.
So we see Trip step off. The rabbit is now off the track, and it's up to the athletes. Willie Fink is up front. They're about 10-15 meters behind the lights. Very, very great to have those and give some perspective to where they are relative to 13:20 pace.
I think Bia Simbasa is struggling a little bit with the bricks. I've seen him a couple times now just kind of take a couple weird steps.
It's very easy to kind of get lost in the guys back in front of you. You're just trying to zone out, forget about everything, and those bricks, you know, they blend in with the rubber red track.
They'll get you. But yeah, this is where it gets tough, because I can tell you the way that I like to race 5K is you try to switch off for 3K, and then you know that 4K is going to suck, and then you get to that 5K and you're like, all right, I can do the rest of this. The fact that the pace has dropped off a little early and they have to start pushing just a little bit earlier, I think that just makes it a bit tougher.
So we now see a couple groups forming. So you have Fink up front leading 5. Behind him is Mason Furlick, Hillary Boer, Kirabella Rasa, and Bia Simbasa. And then a few seconds back, you have Eric Avila leading a second chase group. And so, you know, at this point, Morgan, is it a matter of just trusting your fitness, or is it now finally actually hurting?
It's hurting a lot right now, and you know you still have 2K to go. I think they're about to hit that 3K split. But if you're feeling good, like it looks like a couple of these guys are, you know, you make some moves and you keep it going because you're trying to run a pace. You're not coming here to leave anything on the track. So it's good to see them making some moves.
As they approach 3K in about 804, 805, Kirbel Arasa has taken over the pace from Willie Fink with fellow Hoka athlete hot on his heels, Hillary Bohr. Tell us a little bit about what it is to switch paces off with your competitors, especially at this point in the race when you're trying to still work together to catch those lights.
Yeah, you know, these guys they're running on the line right now. That's what the 5K is. They're running on the line. And so any help that they can get from each other is going to be huge. But, you know, that's why you often need someone who's just gonna have the big enough balls and just take that race.
Is it a matter of the fact that there's no prize money? Does that make a difference when you're in a race and, you know, there's a few thousand dollars on the line? Maybe you're not willing to be as altruistic.
Certainly. I mean, why did all these guys come? The reality is they're here. I mean, they're here for a race, but they're here to run times. Like, that's probably their biggest goal for all of them. So you're definitely much more open to kind of exposing yourself a bit. And I'm sure these guys had some form of a plan before the race because they're doing a great job now keeping the race going a bit when the pace just lagged a little bit.
I do just want to give another shout out. We broke 10,000 viewers in our YouTube.
Let's do 20.
Now.
Let's do 20. Keep sharing the link.
As they approach a mile to go, it was about 9:10, 9:11. And Hillary Bohr throws in a little bit of a surge, and we've got a couple meters back to Kirbel.
Yeah, Hillary Bohr, we shouldn't really be shocked by this. He's run 13:14 indoors. 13:26 outdoors. He won his first steeple title in 2019, so he's now trying the 5K here when there aren't these too many opportunities to steeple. He's trying to put on a little bit of a gap here.
So now it seems like that is really starting to spread out. They were probably running 64-65s, and they had run a 66, and that's when they all bunched up, and then they dropped to 64 just there, and you can see the difference of a couple seconds, and I'm sure a lot of guys wanted to start to relax. It's that you start making deals with yourself. I'll get that second back later.
Yeah, I mean, you see what's happening right now. He doesn't want to be in the lead. You can see just by these guys, I think this is the humidity playing a big part right now because, you know, these guys are it's just a bit tougher than they thought it was going to be, and hopefully they can work together and get that pace back going. But, you know, when the pace falls off, that's when the racing really comes out. So I think we're going to see a really good race at the end, even if they're not quite hitting that time that they wanted to hit.
10:17 with three laps to go.
We see Mason Furlick. He's been up there in the top two, top three position for quite a bit. Did you race him quite often in the Big Ten?
Yeah, man, big rivals.
Really?
Yeah, for my first couple of years, he was there. I beat him a couple of times. He beat me a couple of times. He's a very talented runner. What that guy's done, especially, you know, in the steeple, and now he's doing it on the flat. I'm lucky enough to have paced him to his first sub four last year. So you're welcome, Mason. I hope you do very well in this race.
And that was a 68, so they've clearly slowed down a bit. You had seen them stringing out, and they immediately kind of accordion back together. Bia Simbasa up front, training partner of Ed Cheserek out of Flagstaff. Very beautiful, fluid form, you know, someone that would probably be quite nice to run behind. Makes you feel a little bit easier when you're running behind someone who does it effortlessly.
Now we got Willie going on the front. This is just racing right now. This is awesome.
With 800 meters left, Willie Fink surges to the lead, 11:23 with two laps to go.
What do we tell people? We told people to buy stock on Willie Fink. Let's get a Willie chat going and a Willie chant going in the chat right now.
Out of Eastern Michigan, Willie Fink is a guy who's just buckled up after college and just slowly grinded away.
Just had to stop sleeping on him out of the district track club out in D.C.
And, you know, now they're actually all starting to work together, you know, to just keep this honest. Hillary Bohr to the front. And Mason has just been riding whoever is in the lead. He's running
this
tactically
well.
Like a genius. He hasn't had to lead a single step, and he looks great.
Yeah, and Willie Fink, man, he looks like he's hurting a bit, unfortunately, with still 600 to go. So looks like a race of three.
And that last 400 was 66 seconds. Ooh. So I think that we're going to see something really, really crazy here with 500 meters to go. You see that there's a lot of life in their legs. There's plenty of pop. Mason is responding to everything that Hillary does as he continues to wind up as they approach 400 meters. As they hit the bell, it is going to be 12:26. That Olympic trials qualifying time of 13:25 is very much in sight. That 13:13 is fully out of reach, but I have a feeling that they're going to have a little bit more than just a sub 60, as they're probably forgetting about the clock, and it's all about beating the other guys. Morgan, at what point in this race do you expect Mason to make a decisive move for the front?
Ah, man, he looks good. He looks good, but so does Hillary. I think he's going to – oh, it looks like he's making a bit of a move now, but I think he's going to leave it for a little bit.
With 200 meters, it's 12:56. They're going to need a sub-29. I do believe that is in reach. As soon as you see them swing into lane two, you know that they're going to go shoulder to shoulder and really – get everything out of each other. But Hillary, without any acknowledgement of Mason behind him, starts picking it up. But Mason finally swinging out into lane two.
Here we go.
You see the height difference between the two, and Mason Furlick's loping stride overtakes Hillary Bohr as he comes through the line in 13:25 in a fist pump. Very exciting for Mason Furlick. Good win for Tracksmith. Shout out to them. A beautiful jersey at the front of the race.
So for a little bit, I believe Mason Furlick had held the world lead in the mile when he ran a really early mile earlier in the month in Florida. Now he takes a win here.
Mason Furlick,
strong start to the year for him.
Continuing to just have a breakout year. You know, he does a lot of running with Nick Willis, who...
It's like that group is hitting a good string of luck. You've got Hobbs Kessler, you've got Nick Willis, who extended his sub-4 streak, and now you've got a nice little win here by Mason Furlick.
So we see 13:25.92 for Mason Furlick, and Hillary Bohr, 13:26.7. Bia, 13:27. Arasa, 13:34. Willie Fink just did not have that final lap, 13:42, assuming that the times are all worked out, and that is correct.
Yeah, I did see a tweet already about how I didn't let go of the Willie Fink chant, as soon as I said it, he kind of started to tie up a little bit. I jinxed it.
But one thing I'd like to add is I think it's hard to, a bit underrated, where it's so humid here, and I've had this happen to me before. A lot of these guys are coming from the cold and, you know, the dry. I think that switch is so hard. So I think that's why you saw, you know, just a bit more struggle than you would expect coming to these conditions. But, I mean, that was a great race.
There's Maximilian Thorwith, I believe, on the ground.
That's going to be a tough cool down. What does a cool down look like after a 5K, Morgan? A little
depends
different.
How well you did.
You wouldn't generally work out after a 5K at this point in the year, I assume.
No, I personally wouldn't. I'm sure some of these maniacs might be thinking about it, but if I run well, I kind of like to run for like 30 minutes and just talk with everyone. If I don't run well, I'll either go very short or very long.
So Mason Furlick, 5K, just outside the Olympic Trials qualifying time. There's still a good chance that gets him in, but there will be more opportunities later in the year to find that one final second.
Yeah, and I mean, the big thing is, too, is like we haven't seen him steeple yet, so maybe he's waiting to assess where he's at in that event before he makes a final decision on where he ends up for the trials.
Chris, speaking of the steeplechase, is there anywhere where athletes could possibly find a steeplechase?
That's right. If you love this meet, we're going to be putting on another one in a couple weeks. It's going to be called the Great Barrier Meet. It's going to happen just outside of Kansas City. So stay tuned for more details on that from Trials and Miles Racing.
And we do just want to give another special shout out to our presenting sponsor, Nate Reich. Thank you for stepping up and supporting the game. And we wish you the best of luck in your journey to the Paralympics this year representing Canada.
Yeah, so I'm excited. That was a great race.
That was exciting.
That was really like true racing. And we're going to, you know, hit some replays again because people have been loving it.
Mason, you know, 4,900 meters had the perfect rabbits.
Exactly, man. He ran that so well. He knew what he had to do. He knew he wanted to just sit behind until the time was right, and he pulled it off well.
Do you think anyone wants to cool down with Mason after a race like that?
No, everyone's going to hate him.
Wait,
tonight.
So for the people listening and watching this thing, are you guys saying that Mason just didn't take the lead enough? Is there a little bit of, like, not animosity, that's a really strong word, but just not being up in front? Like, he didn't really lead a lap, right? So what are you guys thinking?
I would say the fact that there were five guys in that lead pack for much of the race that they probably won't even notice until they come back and watch the race and hear us talk about it.
It's so hard to be cognizant of everything that's happening in a race when you're right on the line. So, you know, I've been in that spot before. As a fellow person who doesn't like to lead when they don't have to, I get where Mason was coming from. I don't think, you know, I think that race was a big step forward for him. So I think he just wanted to be up there and compete. That's all he was thinking about. I think some of the other guys, you know, they were thinking about the time a bit more. So, you know, that's why those are the guys that are going to go to the front and keep pushing it. But for Mason, I mean, I don't think you can hold anything against him. I think, you know, coming into this race, I'm not sure exactly what he expected, but I think that was a big jump forwards for him.
Do you think certain guys would handle heat like this or the humidity better than others, or is that all mental?
No, I think some people struggle with it more than others, and I think it's mostly just acclimatizing to it. I think it's that switch that's so hard. I think during the summertime, if you're from somewhere that's humid and you've been training in it, it's fine. It makes a much smaller difference, but I think it's that big switch, which probably a lot of people experience, which makes it really hard.
I always like hearing the stories of just like before a world championships or like an Olympics, like there's just little, because you're going to go into a really, really humid place sometimes, like it's running with garbage bags on or like extra layers. It's like, do you have any funny stories, I guess, prepping for Doha?
I don't like to do anything too crazy, but I can tell you, where before the 2018 Rio games, where Bauman trained, it was Madison, Wisconsin.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, I remember
where the games trained. Madison, Wisconsin. So
there's a Jerry connection there.
There is a Jerry connection.
And it's great running in Madison.
And great running, and it was the same conditions as Rio. You know, it was very humid in both places, so it made a lot of sense. So it's really important to get that training in for sure.